on TV, I think, right? Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. The hour is 7 o'clock, and as mayor, I hereby call to order a meeting of Laconia City Council scheduled for Monday, January 23, 2017. As always, tonight we'll begin our meeting with a salute to the American flag. I would ask that you please rise and join Councilor Bob Hamill in reciting the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. For the record, the minutes to tonight's meeting are being kept by City Clerk Mary Reynolds. And I would ask that she please call the roll.
Councilor Bounds.
Here.
Councilor Lippman.
Present.
Councilor Bear.
Present.
Councilor Hamill.
Yes.
Councilor Baldick.
Here.
Presiding Mayor Edward Engler.
Present. Let the record show that 5 of 6 councilors are present for tonight's meeting, and that establishes a quorum. Also note for the record that the City Council is joined at the front table tonight by City Manager Scott Myers and by the City Finance Director Donna Whitteman. Our first order of regular business is acceptance of minutes. Would call the Council's attention to the minutes, which are on page 5 of your packet, to our meeting on January 9th. Note that those minutes were distributed to the council members on January 17th, and as of tonight, no corrections or changes were received at the clerk's office. So in lieu of any changes at this point in time, I will declare that those minutes have been accepted by the council as submitted by the clerk. Consent and action calendar. We have 2 items tonight. Under consent and action, and I would refer on the first one to you to page 18 of your packet. This is a request to establish rental fees for the boardwalk, the Weirs Beach boardwalk, the Lakeport Fire Station parking lot, and Weirs Boulevard vending spaces for Laconia Motorcycle Week 2017. Presuming that because this is on consent and action calendar, no changes are made, the actual charges are listed on page 19.
Correct.
Motion would be in order to approve the rental fees for Laconia Motorcycle Week 2017 vending spaces located on the Weirs Boardwalk at the Lakeport Fire Station and on Weirs Boulevard as presented.
So moved.
Councilor Hamill makes that motion, seconded by Councilor Baldick. Any discussion? All those in favor, please raise a hand. 5 votes in the affirmative. That motion is approved. Second is a request from the Lakes Region Sled Dog Club to waive license, vendor, and loudspeaking fees as per norm for the February 10 through 12, 2017 sled dog event. Any questions or comments on that?
So moved.
We're going to have enough snow?
Not looking good. You may have to think about postponing, so
I'm not sure if
that's going
to be. So Councilor Baldick moves to approve the request from Laconia Sled Dog Lakes, I'm sorry, the Lakes Region Sled Dog Club to waive license, vendor, and loudspeaker fees for the February 10 through 12, 2017 sled dog event, seconded by Councilor Lippman.
Yes, I just wonder if we should add in there or such Green other date or such other date that occurs in February.
All right, would you consider that a friendly amendment, Councilor? All right, so we have a friendly amendment and second, amending the motion to say February 10th through 12, 2017, or any other applicable date.
Well, it once they cancel it, the dogs are going to go somewhere else, you know. It's just...
So it's not going to happen on
another
date. I doubt
that we would have a second choice, would we?
The second choice is the following weekend, and if we don't get another, you know, don't get a storm, that pops up.
All right, so let's say February 10 through 12, or 17 through 19?
Yes.
All right, so that'll be our friendly amendment then.
That would be better.
To add February 17 through 19th as an alternative date. Okay, everybody got that? Any further discussion? All those in favor, please raise a hand. We have 5 votes in the affirmative. That motion is adopted. Thank you for coming tonight. Okay, citizens' comments for matters not on the agenda. This is the appropriate time of the night for anyone to speak who wishes to address the council tonight on any matter that is not on tonight's agenda. Is there anyone here who'd like to speak to council about a non-agenda item? Nope. Okay. Presentations. I believe we have a presentation tonight from the police chief and the fire chief. Chief Adams, Chief Erickson, welcome to you both.
And Lieutenant Sweat. I've brought him along with me as well, so I hope that's okay.
He's going to do the sweating,
huh? Yeah, he'll do the sweating, so.
All right.
Never heard that one.
Well, good evening. We appreciate, Mary, could you hand these out to the, we appreciate the opportunity to speak to all of you. Mary's handing out, that's just a quick PowerPoint presentation that we printed up describing some of the initiatives that we're going to talk about, including the pet position. So thank you. As you know, about 2.5 years ago, the city of Laconia really started to see an increase in opiate use, specifically heroin and fentanyl. And we developed the pet position about 2.5 years ago, maybe a little bit more, in anticipation of this. As we all know, and I don't have to tell any of you, that we continue to experience issues with opiate abuse here in our community, but not just here in the state and in the nation as a whole. New Hampshire specifically has been hit extremely, extremely hard. But I think I come to you tonight telling you that some of the initiatives that we've undertaken, in part because of the support of the council, has really proven to be successful. And I think you'll see some of the numbers that we're presenting to you that prove that concept. I mean, there's a true wraparound support system that's developing within our community here in Laconia that's fairly unique, I think, to the state of New Hampshire and maybe even to the nation. And it's not just the police, it's every other organization, including the fire department, including the hospital, including treatment and recovery centers. And I think that even though a lot of communities in this state and in the nation continue to see an increase in overdoses, we are seeing, at least within the last 2 to 3 years, a decrease in those numbers. And I would argue that that is in part because of the pet position and some of the other initiatives that we are implementing here. Just to refresh everybody's memory, in 2015, we had approximately 83 overdoses here in our community. And these aren't attempted suicides or an elderly person that accidentally overdoses. These are drug narcotic overdoses, and a majority of them were heroin or fentanyl. And out of those 83, we had 10 fatalities. Last year, 2016, we saw 76 overdoses with 5 fatalities. So even though the state of New Hampshire, other parts of the country, we're seeing a huge increase in overdoses and overdose deaths, we saw a decrease. Now that's still, those numbers are still bad for a community of 17,000. But to me, that is a small positive that's showing that what we are doing is making a difference. And in January so far this year, we've had 4 overdoses compared to 7 last year. So it's an uphill battle, there's no doubt. The fire department, and Chief Erickson will speak about that, and the police department continue to respond to a lot of drug-related calls, whether it's found needles, whether it's crime related to drug use. But I think the enforcement, along with the pet position and now the fire department's position, which I think goes hand in hand with our program, and I couldn't be happier to see that they've implemented that program, I think really is making a difference. I'll let Chief Erickson speak, and then I'm going to ask Lieutenant Sweat to go through this PowerPoint presentation. He'll update you on the pet position, as well as some of our enforcement initiatives as well, and then we'd be happy to answer any questions that you may have. Thank you.
Thank you, Chief Adams. Earlier this year, one of my firefighters, Brian Keyes, took it upon himself to go to school to become a recovery coach. It was about a 30-hour training program, and he did it, nothing to do with the fire department. He wanted to give back, so he became a recovery coach, and mostly towards alcoholism. It was in October he approached, or Chief Riley approached me and said, Brian has an idea to possibly do something within the heroin problem within the city. And the first thing I said to him is, go see Eric Adams and Chief Adams and make sure that we're not conflicting or, you know, in any way overriding on what they're doing. Chief Adams said, this is great. Anything we can do to help get people treatment is an improvement. So Brian, Deputy Chief Riley, met with Dr. Rassicott, and we've created this recovery coordinator within the fire department. And what I, if you could pass these out for me, simply what we're doing is giving out his business card, and when we do have an overdose or a suspected overdose, that business card is given out. Initially, when Brian started this, he thought he was going to have to take a lot of initiative calling people that we were taking to the hospital, when in reality, we're finding these people are calling him, which is phenomenal. They're asking for help. And these are people that are not calling Officer Adams for whatever reason. We do suspect that some of these people are afraid to call a police officer, which is one of the reasons why we wanted to put this together. But since December 6th, Brian's made contact with 22 individuals or family members. 12 of these people are currently in recovery and are sober since this time. 8 are semi-compliant and are working with them. 2 have dropped out of the program, and unfortunately, we're picking them up again. 5 of these people have reached out to see if they can actually do some of this coaching themselves. 6 other fire departments have made contact with him for some assistance in dealing with people in their own communities, and we've also found out whether the only fire department in the state of New Hampshire that's doing anything like this. We looked at the Safe Firehouse program in Manchester and really felt that that wouldn't work in Laconia, only because we don't have enough 24-hour facilities to take these people to, where Manchester has about 18 places. So it's working out very well. He spends a lot of time with Officer Adams. Most of the work he's doing is via cell phone. He can track all his contacts through the cell phone, and people are calling him all hours of the day at night. Since we started the program back in November, the only expenses to the hospital was the cell phone, and there's been about $1,000 in other expenses associated with any extra time that Brian's done meeting with different people, different organizations that are trying to get more input and more involvement. But we have a 54% success rate, which in such a short period of time is phenomenal. And I compliment Brian for this initiative, and we hope it continues to keep moving forward with such great success, because, you know, these are 12 people that we hope are not going to be being brought to the hospital in some cases on a weekly basis. You know, any questions on that?
Good job.
So when I put this together, I just pulled some slides from a PowerPoint that we had established when we go around and do different presentations. And 2.5 years ago when we started this, our initial goal was just right on that first page, is to reduce the amount of overdose deaths, because that's what we were looking at, and we considered that the basic crisis. So about a year ago, Lisa Leary from the Partnership for Public Health did an evidence-based study of how PET was working, and I put a few slides in with that. First one shows what the OD rates have been in New Hampshire, and again, these are only through the end of 2015, but probably all seen on the news, the projections were more for this year, or 2016, and I believe we pretty much hit the mark on that, unfortunately, as a state. In Laconia, the next page talks about how many contacts Eric has had and the success rates. And any program that gets 49% participation is pretty amazing. And the last stat there, 0 deaths from the people that are involved. That's absolutely astounding, given the cycle of addiction. And
highlight some of those numbers.
Oh, okay.
Allow to the public in here.
Oh, sorry about that. But y'all don't have
on
this
TV in the crowd.
So, as of the end of November, Eric had contacted 156 people. 75% of those contacted entered the program. 83 of them went into treatment. 77, which is just under half, are currently in recovery, 60 days or more without a drink or drug. And again, zero deaths resulting from the overdoses for people that were involved in the program. Drew up a strategic plan last year, and I pulled some of the highlights. And again, to continue to expand our community partnerships and networks. The chief alluded to the fact that this is not the police department, it's not the fire department. Laconia is getting behind this. It's an amazing community response. Eric is seeking out training and certifications. He's becoming a recovery coach, which is pretty amazing. We're looking at ways of coming up with a model of early identification to try to short-circuit that path to addiction. And we've recently added a couple interns to leverage Eric's time. So he has two.
What does that mean, interns?
Yeah. What's that?
What does that mean?
They're college kids. I'm not sure what disciplines they're in. I read the packets, promptly forgot it. But what Eric's doing is interesting to their major, so they're getting credit for helping him out.
So they're actually assisting him with making some of the follow-up phone calls, alleviating some of that type of work, so that frees Eric up for other options, and they're free of cost. You know, we don't have to pay them, so.
Are these from NHTI, or were they?
At least one of them is, I believe. I can't remember. Maybe the other one might be Riviera. I was thinking Riviera College, but that could be wrong. Moving on to the next slide, it was, again, the other efforts that we make as a department. For many, many years, we've had a very strong DARE program, and that outreach has been very successful. It reaches a lot of families, not just the kids at school. We make a lot of public presentations into education to parents groups, kids groups, anybody that asks us. We have a great deal of our members are involved in these groups as members, sit on boards to reach out. And I wanted to reiterate that we're the prevention effort really is going to require us to ID early on the high-risk population in children and adults. That's when the prevention can be most effective. Helping somebody that's already in the substance of misuse area is very difficult. A lot of patterns are set. It's hard to break that. We have two detectives assigned pretty much essentially to 100% of drug investigations, and we use our other personnel to leverage their time. We currently are involved in a number of highway safety grants. One of them is specifically for DWI patrols. Under Granite Hammer, we've been doing a lot of high-intensity patrols, plainclothes patrols, and it's giving us a lot of investigative overtime that would strap our budget very quickly. So it's been a very helpful grant to have.
So that's highlighting some of the efforts that we're undertaking. I think we've talked about the dual philosophy for the police department, not just focusing on enforcement. Obviously, enforcement is hugely important. We made well over 200 drug arrests last year. But the other component is just as important. And I think we're seeing some, like I said, some good decreases in the numbers. But we're not naive. We know that this is a huge problem. It's going to continue to be a problem. Other drugs substitute or take the place of the heroin and the fentanyl. We're seeing a lot of methamphetamine use as well. So it's a constant battle, but I think we have the right concept here in this community and within the agencies, police, fire, and the community at large. So I'm happy to answer any questions, concerns that anybody has, or Chief Erickson. Or
Councilor Lippman had his hand up first.
Go ahead.
I was just curious, in terms of my understanding is at the county level, programs that they're implementing with the jail expansion are due, I think, in September next year. How are we working with that? Because I guess oftentimes people may end up there before they begin recovery phase.
Yes.
How we're integrating with that.
So I think this is another program that goes hand in hand with the philosophy that we've undertaken. I believe that construction project is due to be completed in June, so the program's probably will be up and starting in September, like you said. Eric Adams works very closely with the correction facility right now and sees patients there, so this is just enhancing that effort. And obviously, they're going to have more in-depth programming, staffing to assist with the wraparound of the inmate, but as well as the family as well. So I think it's just another component that really is going to help out the overall picture and Eric is involved with it now, and I can only anticipate that he's going to be even more involved with that whole process as it gets underway.
In terms of the community, there's a lot of good things kind of in development stage, and you know, in terms of if you could wave a magic wand and do anything you wanted to do, what would you do differently than you're doing today?
Oh, I thought he was jumping at the question. Apparently not.
Don't have an answer there.
Well, no, I think we're heading in that right direction. Obviously, resources would be wonderful if we could have another Eric Adams along with another two drug detectives. That would be fantastic. But we're living in the world we live in, and we're financially strapped, and this is a tax cap community, and we understand that. So we do the best we can with what we have, and obviously we're very gracious for the three positions that you guys have given us over the last 3-4 years. So yes, in a perfect world, another Eric Adams, some more drug detectives, because both of those sides are overwhelmed right now. But that'd be my answer.
I would say it's really an issue, too, of just more finances from the state level going into mental health and addiction treatment programs. within the city of Laconia, we have a lot of smaller agencies that are all dealing with the drug addiction, alcoholism, homelessness, and all sorts of other issues. There's not one, well, actually, there's one specific place right now specifically for drug addiction, but it's a part-time agency. And I think more money on the state level towards that whole program would be a great thing.
So in that regard, I know the agency that Eric is chair of, Navigating Recovery's, networked into this, but the Community Health Services Network is a regional nonprofit entity that's bringing together various agencies, and the $150 million that the state is drawing down to improve mental health and substance use disorder. They just got our region is called Region 5, which is comprised of like Franklin, Plymouth, and the Lakes region, Laconia area. They potentially will be getting up to, and this is if they meet certain metrics, up to $13 million of funding over the next 5 years to help address the problem. So I think making sure we're networked into that to leverage those funds. And they have specific project areas that they've identified and trying to network into that a little bit further with your team, I think would be useful in terms of bringing some of that money to bear. You know, I think just in terms of those agencies, it's not that they're taking on new responsibilities. It's not like they're getting an influx of money, but they're getting specific targeted money in three project areas. One is related to trying to help the recidivism rate with respect to people who are leaving or entering the prison system. Another one is to increase the number of people who are available to provide treatment, outpatient intensive therapy. And then another area is high need individuals, like people who may have a co-occurring condition like mental health problem and drug addiction, and potentially could be have other disorders, could be developmentally disabled or what have you. But I think that's something that we should be working to get integrated within more.
Thank you.
Councilor Bounds?
My first question was going to be Henry's first question about the coordination with the Belknap County and the new jail. Mm-hmm. The second question relates to the recovery program run by the district court, and I assume that you're all tuned into that and working with Judge Carroll and Jackie Abernoff and all those folks over there.
Yes, we are. Jim Sawyer is actually part of that team, so we're very involved, and we attend the graduations, and Eric Adams is very involved as well. So Great program, but obviously limited as far as what they can do.
It's limited. They don't have any money, but they run it.
Although that's changed.
That's changing, too.
I hope so. They run it on blood, sweat, and tears, but.
The state's funding in the last budget approved funding for each of the 10 counties in that regard, so.
Really?
Yes.
I was unaware of that. That's heartening. The Governor Sununu has bought into this. He's made it his number one of his number one agendas with respect to going forward. So I guess my last question is to you, and is Belmont participating in this? In your role as chief of, are they participating in this? How is that coordination going?
Not directly, but when Brian. Anytime we have a drug overdose, if Brian gives the person their business card, so to speak, or any of our firefighters give a person a business card, that word does get out. He has had Belmont call and see if he could help out, and he's offered some assistance, because Belmont doesn't have a police officer that does it as well. But our focus is strictly Laconia.
Has anybody thought about making the pitch to Belmont selectmen in lieu of your role?
Well, one of the issues really is... you need someone that really wants to do this. This is difficult work, very stressful work, and Brian came to us, and I don't want to get into the details, but Brian understood the problem, and you know, he took it upon himself to go out there and become a recovery coach, and he wanted to start helping people on his own. This is not something that I'm just going to randomly say, hey, you're going to go become a recovery coach. And we are working on that, but you need to get someone that really, really wants to do this work because it is very stressful work. And his focus right now, though, is really he calls these people up almost every single day. Are you going to the center? Are you clean? Are you, you know, are you going to see your priest? Whatever it is they're doing or whatever agency they're going to, he is constantly on the phone hounding them and hounding them and hounding them, and in some cases that's all they need. And a lot of times he is working with their Officer Adams, especially if they have people that really need to go in a different direction, where, you know, if they need to go through the court system as an example. But a lot of it is just persistence and that desire to do that. So finding someone that wants to do it is we're working on that.
Councilor Bolduc.
Yes. Are these people made to pay for any of this, or is it just coming out of the taxpayers' pocket?
No, they don't. We don't charge them for it. It's part of the police department and the position that's there. Yeah, we don't get into.
If they can afford to buy this stuff, why can't they pay?
Well, as you know, I've spoken about the issue of addiction and how complicated it can be. Oftentimes, there's a lot of personal reasons, medical reasons, mental health reasons that lead to addiction, and obviously,
I mean, you could have the same person going down the street 80 miles an hour. You're going to stop them and fine them, and they're going to have to pay the bill. Why can't they pay?
I don't think the police department's in the position to charge people for.
Well, somehow it's.
I understand your frustration. I get it, but I just
there's a lot of.
I don't like paying for something that I don't use, and they should.
You know, the flip side of it is to think of if that position did not exist, what would be the cost to this community, not only in lives, but financial costs, costs associated with loss of business, employee work hours. If those, and I forget what the numbers are, but if those 80 people that are in long-term recovery right now because of Eric Adams, if they weren't, and it's a hypothetical question, but I'd venture to guess that the cost of the position that all of you approved is lesser than the cost of those 88 people if they were out on the street. But I get your frustration.
I did want to point out on the fire department, and there's no cost to the city. It's being funded through the partnership with the hospital. So, you know, it's not being funded by taxpayers. The hospital's picked up the cost on the fire department end.
Councilor Hamill.
I'd just like to say that I'm pretty impressed with the strides that have been made in the last 3 years. It's kind of a sad thing to say, impressed with the strides when we're still having problems the way we are. But 3 years ago when we started this and we asked Chief to come here and come up with a solution, because we were having a lot of fatals in Laconia. And, you know, he went back and came up with a plan, and it looks like it's really working. You know, this council didn't want to bury its head in the sand over a problem that we had in our city, and we didn't do that. And I'm pleased with the direction you're going in and the people you're helping, because I'm seeing them every day down there. just curious, when we started this program, do you recall how many fatals we had in Laconia from...
The first year?
Yeah.
It was 15, I think, the first year. What was it?
Would that have been 2000 and... I don't think it...
About 2.5 years ago, I think.
I don't think it was that high. I think 2015 was one of the highest years we've had. When we were going through the methadone issue, we had 8 that year. So I don't think it was at 10 that
last year
before.
I think it was
last
spring of 2014 when we asked you to come to a meeting.
Okay, so last year we had 5. The year before, 2015, we had 10. 2014, if I had to guess, I'd say 7 to 8 fatalities.
I guess it was 1 year we had 12 or 15. And it was questioning. We were waiting for the end of reports on what the final number was.
Yeah, I don't. 12.
And of the 4 we've had so far this month, any fatals?
No fatals.
His last Thursday was 2, same within a couple hours.
The firefighters are doing a great job. Firefighters are doing a great job saving these people. And you know, I know last week in one day, 2 people were given the business cards. Both of them reached out to Brian the next day. So that's encouraging. They were both clinically dead the day before, and now they're not. Because of the efforts of our employees. And we hope that, you know, they become viable citizens again. That's the goal, is to get these people off drugs and become functioning society. It's not an easy task. But if we don't do it, it's just going to get worse and worse and worse.
Yeah. Now you said that there's several small agencies in Laconia that provide some services. And we ran into this several years ago, quite a few years ago now, where we've had social programs or groups that come in front of the council and ask for funds and this and that. And when you ask them what they do, it's very similar amongst them. And there might have been 10. So we asked them to, you know, instead of having 10 people, 10 directors, 10 places to pay for and all that there, go back and see if you can get together and make one that's, or a couple, that's going to be big enough to make things worthwhile. Now, the groups that are providing the services for drug addiction or mental health or whatever, is that something that instead of having, I don't know how many they're out there now, 5, 6, 7, 8, whatever, asking them to reorganize into something that would be more effective and have more money to work with and more people instead of, you know, trying to have a few that really can't do the job?
You can answer this.
That's exactly what the Community Health Services Network's doing, Bob.
Okay.
You know, I've chaired that over the last year. And so like Genesis Behavioral Health, Horizons Counseling, Lakes Region Community Services Council, there are 15 community agencies that play some role in the region in mental health and substance use disorder services, trying to coordinate services among us. Health First being another one that's based in Laconia, but they created a network to bring the available funds in and try to coordinate services better. But you know, the reality is that if you look at Jackie Abacoff's agency, Horizons Counseling, you know, I think the staff is you know, 3 or 4 people covering all of Belknap County, part of Grafton County, part of Merrimack County. And, you know, just from Jackie's calculations as an example, the region is, you know, probably would need 3 times the number of people we currently have it to, and that's, you know, they realistically understand we can't get there, but that's why we're working together to try to leverage off the different resources that are available. You know, some of it is trying to find out, you know, there are different rules and regulations that, you know, Governor Sununu has, you know, asked folks how they could help, that you know, just there are different things that could be done to take away some of the inefficiencies that agencies have, but some of those are sort of regulatorily imposed. And so that is something I think the agencies are working on.
Thank you.
Anyone else? Okay, thank you very much, all three of you,
thank
for
you
taking the time to come see us this evening. We appreciate it. Mayor's report, I'll keep this brief. Just wanted to update everyone on some state school property developments. You may have read this in the papers, but we have a new development on the state school front, and that is that the president of the New Hampshire Senate, Chuck Morse of Salem, didn't like the direction, I guess it would be fair to say, that things were progressing on this front, and so he put in his own bill to form another committee. And before I criticize that, and I'm not going to, I don't think his intention is to really have another committee in any normal sense of the word, because the committee that he outlined is due to issue its findings within like 2 months. And report back, and it's totally comprised, I think, of like 3 senators and 2 House members. A public hearing was immediately held. You can have an immediate public hearing if you're chairman of the Senate, I guess. So an immediate hearing was called on his bill for last week. It passed the committee unanimously, no surprise. And my understanding is that bill will be voted on by the Senate on Wednesday, and obviously is almost certain to pass. Its fate in the House, I have no idea. What's going to happen there, but not surprisingly, during the testimony last week at the hearing on his own bill, basically Senator Morse was telling his fellow senators that he doesn't want this whole issue drug out another 2 minutes, and he doesn't want the state to have to pay another dime. And his whole intent here is to short-circuit the current process and have this happen really quickly. And I think his desire, as stated at the committee meeting, is that by hook or by crook, he wants to see Laconia own that property as soon as humanly possible. At what price, I don't know. It hasn't stated publicly. But he's not interested in, he wants it off the books, I think, by the end of the fiscal year. For the state, and doesn't want them spending any more money. They're spending almost $400,000 a year on maintenance and upkeep to that facility, and he doesn't want to pay for that anymore. He also doesn't want a dime spent. He has articulated he doesn't want a dime spent on realtors. He doesn't want a dime spent on marketing. He doesn't want another penny of state money spent on that. So while that was happening, the committee that was formed last fall by the governor and council got its final report in draft form. Matt Leahy, who's been representing us in that committee, gave me a copy of that, of the final draft, and there were really no changes on that, some significant changes from the last draft I saw, and I think could be characterized as being a plan to market and sell the property as is, warts and all. And I think there's some skepticism in some quarters as to whether or not anybody in their right mind would buy it under those circumstances, certainly a private buyer. And I think that's one of the reasons why Senator Morse wants to short-circuit that process, because he doesn't want marketing money and whatnot spent on something that's not likely to happen. And then on the third front, we have our old friend Gene Chandler, representative from the town of Bartlett, who still maintains that he doesn't want to see the property leave the state's hands at all, and he has sponsored a bill in the House to short-circuit the governor and council effort which bypasses the normal procedure to get the property sold. So we have three different efforts going on basically at the State House at this time, I guess we're just interested observers at this point, knowing full well that if they do decide to sell the property, that if they do get an offer, we will have the right to match that offer if we care to at the appropriate time. So we're just kind of monitoring it. Counselor?
Is there some way we could find out that their expenditure of $400 and get a itemized of what that is spent on?
Yeah, we've talked about that, and I think as it gets closer to we have made inquiries, and I have met with Mike Connors from Administrative Services about that and have a basic understanding of it. A lot of that is security. It really falls in three separate categories. They basically mothballed the campus up there pretty much. They have minimal electricity use up there. Most of the buildings are shut down and mothballed, but they are paying a private company to patrol the grounds 24/7. Mm-hmm. So that's a pretty good sized bill, and the reason for that is because people were breaking in and stealing the copper wiring and that sort of thing, and so they've got their own security people up there on that, not state security people, but people who've been hired to watch the premises. And then they in the summer months they pay somebody to hay it and take, you know, that sort of thing as well.
They pay somebody to hay it?
Yes.
Well, they mow the lawn.
Well, mow, yeah.
Yeah, I thought they would buy it.
I think they're paying somebody to, I think they have maintenance costs on keeping up the fields and grounds. Yeah. But anyway, that as we get closer to that, that is certainly one of the things we're going to want to tie down as close to the penny as we can in terms of if we were to become the owners tomorrow, even if they gave it to us, what would it cost us?
That's my point.
To maintain the property, you know, short term, even if we did, you know, nothing the first year or whatever, how much would it cost us to do that? So anyway, so we're keeping an eye on it, and I think, you know, honestly, the best thing we can do now, at least publicly, certainly, is just kind of keep a low profile and let them fight it out, and what happens happens.
So at one point the plan was to put it on the market and see what they got. That just never happened.
No, that's still, I don't know how you want to label the plans. If the governor and council plan is A and Bartlett's Chandler's plan is B and Morse's plan is C, then plan A is still that.
Okay.
But put it on the market and pay a company to market the property. They'd have to go out for requests for proposals to see who would want to represent the state in selling it, et cetera, through that whole process. That would have to be approved yet by the governor and council. So that's where that report is headed next.
Okay.
But like I said, Senator Morris doesn't want to see that happen because he thinks it's going to take too long and waste too much money. So he'd like to short circuit that whole process.
Didn't that go out once already and nobody bid on it?
Yes.
Yeah.
And nobody bid on it.
Yeah. Correct.
And with all the restrictions they've put on that property, not the least of which is the designated receiver facility staying put, and as is with the hazmat issues the property has, I don't think anybody is predicting there's going to be a flood of people.
Plus the water sewer that they added.
Yeah, making offers and whatnot. So anyway, committee reports. We had a meeting of the Finance Committee tonight. Councilor Whitman?
Yes. We took up the legislation that was passed last session on expanded veterans credits for property taxes, and also considered a legislation that's been introduced to help communities potentially phase that credit in. I think it was the consensus of the committee that the credit's a worthwhile thing to pursue, but we'd like to see where the potential enabling Senate Bill 80 in this session goes so that we can make sure that we can afford to introduce that in a way that is fair to all the taxpayers. And so that was a recommendation that came that out of it, that we would bring it back to the full council, you know, pending action on Senate Bill 80 in this session.
So it'll just stay on the committee's agenda for now?
Yes.
Okay. Any questions on that issue? Okay, anything else on committee business tonight?
I'm sorry. Did we want to ask if the council, the consensus was to support that so we can take a position and on Senate Bill 80 and therefore be able to communicate that to the Senate committee and
everyone the House committee? Everyone comfortable with that there being a consensus position of the council?
I thought we got to vote on it.
Yeah.
We should vote on it?
Yeah. Well,
do you want a motion?
I'm fine with the consensus. I mean, it's not binding, but I'll draft it. That way I can follow it as it goes through the Senate and into the House and make sure the committees get
okay.
Look
I think you
position.
Have the consensus, and the minutes will reflect that.
Thank yep. you.
Any other committee business? Liaison reports? Anyone? Okay, citizens request a comment on current agenda items. Is there anyone in our audience tonight who would like to address the council on any matter that is anywhere on tonight's agenda? No one? Okay, moving along then, we are to the city manager's report. Mr. Myers.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Included in your packet for the second meeting of the month, we have your project update. As I had mentioned during the Finance Committee meeting, we just recently extended one of the options we had with Busby Construction to continue the city's road paving projects for the next construction season. City's approach is going to be similar to what we've targeted over the last couple of years in trying to get about 5 or 6 miles of roads done on an annual basis. That means catching some roads while their pavement condition index, the PCI, on a scale of 1 to 100 is somewhere in the 55 to 65 range. That's when roads start to deteriorate. But if you can do a maintenance shim or an overlay and catch the road before it goes into, you know, full failure needing to be ground and reclaimed, you can stretch your paving dollars almost a 3-to-1 or a 4-to-1 ratio. So we're trying to capture some of the roads that needed in that 55 to 65 rating index, and then at the same time we realize we've got some roads that have fallen well below that or are in failure, and obviously those roads the reconstruction cost is much greater. So we're trying to blend together so we get around 5 or 6 miles on an annual basis. I think the city maintains around 78 miles of paved streets, so if we can, you know, all things being equal, we know some roads are dead ends and side streets and don't get the traffic count and don't need the attention as often as some of our main thoroughfares, but again, that's a target we're shooting for, and certainly with the proposed budget that I bring to you later on, we'll be looking to put an adequate amount to continue an appropriate paving schedule. The Messer Street drainage issue, we're working on the final design there. We'll have to get permission from the state DOT to cross under the railroad tracks in that area in order to do the layout, but we'll be looking to do the construction on that sometime this summer as the permitting gets in place. And then the Weirs Beach restoration, Kevin Dunleavy has been working with the Woods Hole Group, who was our consultant. We've got a preliminary plan that we're setting up a meeting with the state DES so we can make sure that the state is on board with our approach towards what we'd like to do down at the Weirs Beach for dealing with the erosion issues down there and do some of the beach restoration. We'll be looking to update the council probably at one of our meetings in March to bring everybody into the fold as to what we think our agreed to approaches with all parties involved, and then determine if we've got the necessary funds there to complete everything. So kind of stay tuned for that. Not included in your projects update, but it's just come to light in the last week or so, is the approach to milfoil treatment for the coming summer season. Suzanne Purley, as a resident on her own, does a great job in coordinating milfoil activities for us in Paugus Bay in particular. She also focuses on Lake Opeachy with a small group of neighborhood associations who really help contribute and leverage the dollars. She does a great job in reaching out to some marinas and private property owners that benefit from the lake as well, and gets a a good amount of private dollars, along with some DES, Department of Environmental Service funds. So we're targeting some certain areas in Paugus Bay. Some of it's going to be done, they call it diver-assisted suction harvesting, dash harvesting, and other areas where it's, the milfoil is more prevalent, they're looking to treat chemically. Obviously, one of the issues we have is our surface water comes out of Paugus Bay, and we're very cognizant of that. I know the Board of Water Commissioners is cognizant of that as well. We did some chemical treatment at the very northern end, if you will, I believe, of Paugus Bay a couple of years ago, measured it, monitored it, were very careful with it, had no issues with anything detectable coming in. So those types of cautions are still in place. We do have a Amy Smagula, who heads the invasive species program for the state DES, is coming to the Water Commission meeting on Thursday morning, and that's going to be a topic of discussion with Seth Nettleman and his Board of Water Commissioners. The state, I'll be there as well. Conservation Commission certainly is looking at this from the role they play within the city, but we want to make sure we can be effective with our dollars and the milfoil treatment for the quality of our lakes, but at the same time, we're extremely cognizant of our water source in Laconia. So I just want to let you know that that is occurring. That is a public meeting at 8 o'clock on Thursday morning up at the facility on Stark Street. But again, a lot of eyes, and everyone's being very cautious on the chemical portion of the treatment in the areas of Paugus Bay that are targeted. And with that, I'll be happy to take any questions if you have any.
Councilor Bear.
Would you bring us up to date on the Winnipesaukee River Basin or West? There was a meeting on the 19th.
Yeah, I think I can give you an update. So two pending issues, if you will, right now. I think you recall a month ago, maybe 6 weeks ago, I shared with you that the communities had made a request of the state asking that if we moved forward with some kind of a regional ownership and operation of the Winnipesaukee River Basin Program's assets, the Interceptor, would there be any anticipated cost for the involved communities to purchase those assets, whereas going back 40 years or so, the majority of the money, I mean, I think it was 95% of the money came from federal funds, and there was very little state dollars into it. And we've got an aging system that we know is going to need some upgrades. So we've asked for clarification to that question, what, if any, cost would be. Then Commissioner Burak, who now has retired from DES somewhere around the first of the year, indicated that he would move that request along to the, I believe it was the Attorney General's office for an answer or an interpretation of anything and come back to us with an answer. To date, I don't believe we have heard anything back, unless it's been something recent.
At our last meeting, they basically said the final draft is at staff at DES for review, and once that's done, they'll be expecting an answer to the committee members.
So the reason we asked that question is, if in looking forward to a regional ownership where the communities had more control over it, as opposed to it being a DES operation, when DES is really a regulatory agency and here they are operating a wastewater plant. That's not a knock against DES or their staff. It's just this is the only treatment plant they operate in the state, and we're thinking there may be some more efficient models, as are in areas in New England that do that. But again, the big question before we got too far down this path was, you know, if the state was going to come and say, sure, you can acquire it, but it's going to be a $20 million price tag, you know, that's probably going to stop us in our tracks immediately, versus if the answer is we'll transfer to you for a dollar and then we'll work through how we might go forward on the regional ownership. So that's one component. The second one is, there is a piece of legislation that is in the House right now, I believe, that is talking about requiring communities to set aside a certain amount of funds in order to put it into a reserve account for their share of the infrastructure underground for replacement cost. And obviously, if there's a big difference between the word shall or may, and we're working on some of those language interpretations, again, so that we have a say. I want to stress that it's all local dollars that pay for the operation of the program. It's under state control. We need to follow the state hiring program, the state job descriptions and positions that they have available to us may not be the right match. Again, this is the only operation of its kind that DES oversees in the state of New Hampshire. So that's why we're having discussions about, is there a different ownership approach? Again, nothing set in stone, and as I mentioned, any type of change in ownership would need to go to all of the communities involved to have their governing bodies sign off on it. But we're looking at this legislation on what it may do to our sewer budget if we're required all of a sudden to start putting away money into reserves and someone else is dictating those levels. So those are a couple of the big things that are in play right now.
Has DES been running this since the beginning?
Counselor, can you use your mic, please?
DES been running this since the beginning?
I believe they have, yes. I can't say 100% certainty, but I'm fairly certain they've been running it, if not since day one, for many, many years.
Okay. Counselor Hamill.
Scott, DES, are they looking back into, I think at one time they provided funding for that. I seem like I read somewhere where the state is now looking to put funds back into projects, water sewer projects that they haven't funded.
Those were state aid grant funds that has nothing to do with this one. This is more recent wastewater or sewer treatment projects where the state has funded on some newer construction that communities had counted on, kind of like a bridge aid program where there's a match involved and the state had committed but they never funded them. So a similar type of thing but a completely different animal.
Yeah, well, see, the reason why I was wondering is, I mean, the Winnipesaukee Basin was basically funded state and federal when they did that whole project.
Yeah. I think it was 95% federal.
Federal, right. Yeah. If that went to be ownership of the towns using it, would that stop us from getting any future state funding or state grants or...
I don't know the answer to that per se. I mean, some of the grant projects or the programs tie into water quality and community need, and I think there's actually more of an effort to support regional approaches as opposed to each community kind of siloing and doing their own. But I don't believe there's been any state money that's flown into this project for years, so I certainly don't want to promise a rosy picture and say if we do this, you know, we're going to qualify for a ton of grants. I know Councilor Lippman had brought up one source of the SED's potential as a economic development for maintaining, and we certainly will monitor and see if some of those are. But I'm not optimistic that state is going to step up and start funding some of the cost of.
What was that percentage of that? 20-something percent, is it?
Well, it's...
What that we do?
I think there's a couple of components. One is tied to the volume and our use in the system, and the other one is tied into the capital assets. And there's even a few gray areas there that not only Laconia, but some other communities are trying to clarify with the state of, is this a locally owned component of the sewer system, which means local dollars pay for its repair, versus is this DES ownership of a system, and therefore it's the program cost. So there's... you know, there's some gray areas that we're stumbling across collectively as well.
I would like to briefly call the council's attention on page 23 of this report, where it talks about the downtown TIF district, to a sentence in here that says, the advisory board and some members of the public expressed concerns about the amount of time it was taking to develop a plan for the parking garage. And to my knowledge, the council is not involved in any way, shape, or form in developing a plan for the parking garage. And I know that we have asked, per direction from this council, for the Down Main Street Initiative to take the lead in looking at the overall issue of parking in the downtown and what needs to be done on a short-term, medium-term, and long-term basis. And perhaps, theoretically, the parking garage could be a portion of that study or that question. But I don't want there to be any misunderstanding on the part of the public or the specifically the TIF advisory board that we're lagging behind on developing a plan for the parking garage, because there is no plan for the parking garage, is my understanding, and they should be well aware of that or made aware of that.
And happy to expand upon that. So it was a meeting that I was asked to attend. I made it clear that at this point, other than maintaining operations to access that second floor, the city wasn't investing any additional dollars, and that the council had requested the downtown Main Street initiative to focus on parking and come back. I did actually send out an email to the head of that organization. I was looking at my emails on Friday, and I sent something out on January 6th and then followed up again. Might have even been this morning, Friday or this morning, but followed up again because I hadn't gotten a response, just looking to be able to find out a status so that we could at least get the council up to speed on where they were in doing that review. But I don't have any additional information to share with you at this point.
Got one more question.
Councilor Hamel.
Scott, are we on schedule for the replacement of the streetlights to LED?
Yes, so we had
a
kickoff meeting with Siemens last week. They may have even started performing the audit at the end of last week, if not more than likely this morning. It's about a two-week period for them to go through and do a complete audit and make sure the records that we have and Eversource have all line up to the number of streets and the wattage and all of that. They have ordered a good chunk of the light infrastructure. We more than likely will be expecting to see light fixtures being changed out in mid-February would be the start. So maybe around 3 weeks from now. They anticipate to being able to change out 300 fixtures a week. On average, we've got 1,300 and some odd fixtures to be changed, so 4+ weeks, call it 5 weeks. So the anticipation is if they start mid-February, that by the latter part of March or the end of March, they should be substantially complete, and then there'll be some follow-through and punch list and nighttime drive-by in those types of things to, you know, to finalize the project. But you probably see some, you probably won't see it, but these next 2 weeks will be kind of behind-the-scenes audit type of work. But then by mid-February, you'll be seeing vehicles here and 300 fixtures a day. Week being swapped out.
Right, and we're still in line for the credit from Eversource.
We have confirmed, we have a letter from Eversource last week that confirmed they're encumbering $100,000 towards our rebate, and once we get the final audit numbers from Siemens, we'll be looking to schedule a finance committee meeting, because by that time that'll firm up our numbers fairly well, and we want to come back and bring options to the finance committee about financing this and what time frame makes sense to do that. Again, the cost savings is going to be 50% off of our streetlight energy bill, which is about $210,000 a year right now. That'll be cut in half. After rebates, the project's going to cost us somewhere around $250,000 ballpark, waiting on the final numbers. You know, a payback of 2.5 years, which is really makes it a great project.
Anyone else? Okay, we're going to move on to new business. First item of new business on page 27 of your packet is a request to accept the Memorandum of Understanding between the Town of Guilford and the City of Laconia regarding the Black Brook Pump Station Power Expense Cost Sharing. Mr. Myers?
So long and short, this cost sharing has been in place for a number of years. The state is upgrading its accounting and software system. They were performing this transaction internally. Part of Guilford's sewer flow comes through into Laconia, and we've been billing them for appropriate cost. The new state system doesn't allow for this credit to and from to occur, so we need to direct bill, but again, the structure of it and the amount and everything isn't in question. It's just we're doing a direct memorandum of understanding for billing from Laconia to Guilford, as opposed to it being part of a credit within the overall system that DES oversees. So it's nothing new in the sense that it's a housekeeping matter, because we're going to direct bill.
Questions or comments before we get to making motions? Councilor Bear.
But it's not, it's coming directly to Laconia, but will we direct it to the Winnipesaukee River Basin?
It's already flowing. That was the closest access point to have it join into the interceptor system, so it's been flowing through that point, but it's now being pumped through some of our pump stations and stuff, so this
I meant the revenue.
The revenue will come into our sewer system enterprise fund, so the revenue will be going there. Right now, it's working as a credit, so in other words,
right.
DES is allocating the expenses, and they've been crediting us and billing out Guilford. For whatever reason, they're no longer able to do that, so it'll be a direct bill from us to Guilford.
What's the 31% amount to, do you know?
I don't know what it equates to in dollars.
I'd have to check.
Anyone else? Okay, a motion would be in order to move to accept the Memorandum of Understanding, which is on page 28, between the town of Guilford and the city of Laconia regarding the Black Book Pump Station Power Expense Cost Sharing, and to authorize the city manager to sign the document on behalf of the city.
So moved.
Moved by Councilor Bolduc. Is there a second? Councilor Bowen seconds that motion. Any discussion? All those in favor, please raise a hand. And five votes in the affirmative, that motion is approved. Okay, second item of new business tonight is an update on the effort to is a request for no parking on sections of Mechanic Street and Warren Street. And this is a memorandum in your packet that starts on page 29 with maps to follow. And are we going to directly recognize Mr. Anderson on this, or do you want to start?
We can, or I can give you a brief overview, and if we need more specifics, okay, Wes can certainly jump in. So let's focus on the Mechanic Street item first. That is, you've got a little map on page, would be 31 of your packet. So basically, it's the area coming off Union Ave along the strip mall in the side and into the bend back of Canton. A number of vehicles that have been parking on the sidewalks there, forcing cars to curve out a bit, also having pedestrian traffic not being able to utilize the sidewalk and therefore cutting out into the street to walk around the trucks. You can see that staff did do the outreach to folks at Seven Gables Mall, 11 Mechanic Street, Tom Canton, Don Kendall, and there's agreement there, and John Moriarty at the mall understands. And I guess you can say it says there, while not happy about the restriction, he is supportive. So we did that outreach. Happy to answer any questions, or Wes is available to answer any further questions that you have on making that a no parking section.
So who requested this?
A couple of neighbors, one neighbor in particular in that area, had seen that on a regular basis and indicated that people walking in the street and even trucks coming up and blocking driveway and stuff while they were unloading and that type of stuff. So it was a neighbor-initiated request.
And is this, that building there at Top Center, that's the, is that the overhead door business?
No, that would be.
Or is that Canton's auto body?
No, Canton's would be to the right with all the cars in the parking lot. That would be the end of where the laundromat is that has Annie's catering.
Well, I'm sorry. I'm looking at it. It'd be on the right-hand side.
Yes. So that's the end of the Seven Gables where it has the.
Right here.
The laundromat.
Yeah.
Right-hand side.
Yes.
Yeah.
I think he's
Seven Gables
oh,
is
oh,
down.
Oh, sorry. By, up over in the back
rent
of there.
Overhead door.
That's yes, the overhead
I'm
door.
I'm sorry.
Place.
I thought you were talking about the building with the white roof.
I didn't notice them being mentioned in here.
I think it where the no parking would stop is before their property line, and we don't think that's necessarily an impact to them.
I didn't have this on mine.
So what is that? What is this building right here?
Which
kind of has a blue-gray roof?
That's the
Mr. Dunn. Can you tell us what
that's
that?
The door?
I have to go out too.
I don't have.
Just for the record, I'm Calvin Dunn III.
Either that or I'm blind.
Me and my fiance built a house at 11 Mechanic Street, which we just moved into the day after Christmas. I have about a dozen photos I'd like
streets.
You guys to look at. I guess we'll start with you. You guys can pass them around.
Parking.
Okay. It's probably a lot better than the photo you've got.
Thank you.
Basically, photo number one is a telephone pole that I had asked to pay to have removed when I started this project. They told me I could not move it. So basically, I am stuck to a very narrow area between that telephone pole and the existing laundry net, which is where I had to put my driveway. If I would have been allowed to move that telephone pole, the driveway could have been away from the laundry mat, and a lot of issues probably would have been resolved. As of today, There's no wires on that pole, and they are removing it. Unfortunately, I have a paved driveway, I have a drainage system put in, I have stone pillars at the end of the driveway. It's a little too late for me to move my driveway. There's been an issue there for about 10 years with people parking there, snow removal going there, all kinds of issues. It really came to our attention back in April when me and my fiance started building, and we were up there every day and night and every weekend. And we were like, I cannot believe the amount of people that are parking in the driveway. From people actually parking, bringing baskets of laundry in the side of the laundry mat, to delivery trucks, to, pretty much everything.
Are they parking in your driveway, Kevin?
Yeah.
Okay.
The problem is when you turn in Mechanic Street, there's nowhere to park.
Right.
They see that huge driveway, and they're like, oh, I'm just going to be here for 5 minutes.
Yep.
Whether you're there for 5 minutes, 5 hours, or 5 days, it's an inconvenience to me. Yeah.
You want to get out.
It's a safety issue. The kids are walking out around the traffic into the road. It's a blind corner. Oncoming traffic cannot see. I have traffic coming up and down the hill, which consists of a lot of heavy commercial vehicles. And in the winter months, which is about 5 months out of the year, the hill is very difficult to maintain. And the last thing I need to do is be slip sliding down the hill and have a car parked at the bottom and I slam into a car. So all of this traffic that gets parked in my driveway is 100% to do with the Eight Gables Mall. Whether they're doing laundry, whether they're doing a delivery, or whether they're running in to get a sub at Subway. Nobody talks and goes over to Canton's. Nobody talks in my driveway and goes over to Napa. It's all to do with the mall because they don't have adequate enough parking. They don't have enough green space. The building is too large for the footprint of the building is actually too large for the area that they have. I was butting heads with the owner for years on this issue, and finally I had it surveyed, and the back of their building is 3 feet on my land. Now, I'm not talking about the setback. I'm talking the actual building is 3 feet over onto my land. So, I mean, that just shows you how out of code this building is. At this point in time, I really have no choice. I'm asking the city to post a no parking zone in that section for the safety of the other people that live on Mechanic Street, the kids, my kids going up and down the hill. It's a bad, bad area. Sorry. This happened last summer, or actually 2 summers ago. I get a lot of advertising out of this. Not the kind of advertising that I'd like. I really want to avoid this. I don't need another issue like that.
Okay, thank you. All right, so what this memorandum does not outline exactly what the procedure here would be?
Well, staff is recommending the no parking on Mechanic Street on page 30, so if the council was ready to take that action tonight, you could make that a motion and do that. Again, we've done outreach to the other existing abutting property owners that we've included in your background. I know on occasion the council has referred this to Government Operations Committee or something for further discussion, so we didn't want to predetermine what your motion might be, but you were
so
able to.
So is a public hearing required on something like this?
I don't think so for this one.
Okay. All right, so what's the will of the council at this point in time?
Well, I drive this road every day because I live up on Prospect
every
Street.
Day.
Every day. And every day it's a problem. So I would support the no parking zone as delineated by the city's recommendation.
And I would second it because I use it a lot and it's tough.
Do you want to make a motion then?
I make that motion.
All right. So Councilor Bounds makes a motion to accept the recommendation of the Department of Public Works Director to ban on-street parking on Mechanic Street from the intersection of Union Avenue to the end of the house at 29 Mechanic Street. That motion is seconded by Counselor Bolduc. Any discussion? All those in favor, please raise a hand. 5 votes in the affirmative, and that motion is approved, and the ban is in effect. Thank you.
Could I ask you one question?
I'm sorry?
Could I ask you one question?
Sure.
If people continue to park there, what procedure should I take?
Call the police.
You have to ask the police department that.
Call the police.
So just call the police, there'll be no parking signs up, the police will come ticket them, and then they won't park anymore?
That would go through the police department, obviously, yes.
Okay.
We will look to install those signs as soon as practicable, and I don't know if that'd be tomorrow morning or what the condition is of the ground there, but as soon as practicable, we will make an effort to get those signs.
Okay.
So the second item, Mr. Mayor, on that same thing for the parking is Warren Street. This was initiated by a resident. We do have a map there as well, but there is a steep hill there, and at the crest of the hill, near house number 68, staff have driven it, police have looked at it. With parking on the street, when you're coming over the crest of the hill, any cars parked on the street do come upon you very quickly and causing you to take a, I won't say necessarily evasive action, but certainly a sharp turn or a little bit of a swerve to get out of the way with streets there. So we've identified the area on your map on page 32 where the recommendation is for no parking. We sent 14 letters to Warren Street residents that would be affected by the ban. 7 residents responded, 6 were in favor of the no parking ban, and 1 strongly opposed to it. The property, if you look on your map on page 32 that was opposed, is the one right above the little label that says no parking either side. It's that little lot where you can read the number 30, and you can see that it's a very small lot. It does not go as deep as any of the other lots on that street. My understanding is there's a space for 1 vehicle to park on the property based on the location of the house, and that gentleman's concern was having people come and visit his house, where would they park? And if this no parking were to go in place, then they obviously would need to park in front of another house on Warren Street, 3 houses before, 3 houses after, because that house sits where the crux of the problem is, right at the top of the hill with a crest. But you can see that lot really is out of character with the remaining number of lots in that neighborhood, and most of them are easily able, if not all of them, are easily able to satisfy their parking needs the overwhelming majority of the time on their own lot.
And who made this request?
It was a neighbor on the street in that stretch there who had called in and requested that we look at it.
So is the crest of the hill right there at that gentleman's property?
Yes.
68? And he's the one person who's very much opposed to this?
Correct, sir.
Now, is the issue going either direction?
It is, because of the steepness of the hill. You can actually park a car on either side of that hill, and you can't see it on the other side. The cars can basically hide. So until you crest it, you won't see it, a car that's parked on the other side of the hill.
And is there a particular issue as to, is the neighbor who complained, are they complaining about houses, about cars parked specifically at 68 or at some, or just in general?
Just in general up on the top of the hill, either side or on the either side of the hill. It was just the safety factor associated with not being able to see it as you're coming down the street.
Have there been any accidents?
Not recently, sir.
Sure, where else?
But we've also recently paved it, too, so
that increases. I'm sorry?
We also recently finished paving it, so the road's in better condition, which means susceptible to a higher speed.
Councilor Hamill, do you have any observations on this? Since it's your ward.
Well, I've been over that road several times, and it is a pretty good hill. But I would think the ones involved would be the neighbors right there at the crest of that hill would be the ones that would tend to park there, not somebody from down the street.
Unless they're having a big graduation party or something or other, probably. I drove it today and looked at it. There was one vehicle parked there today, but it was well off the road. I mean, it was, I hate to say this out loud, but it was,
it's not a Counselor
Bolduc's sake, but it was it was parked well off the street.
Yeah, on the brand new sidewalk, right?
Okay, what's the will of the council here? Approve this, not approve it, send it to committee.
Propose on the committee, the parking.
I would think this would go to public safety.
Is there anybody here speaking on that?
Well, the Public Works Department did a survey and made a recommendation, didn't you, Wes?
We sent it to the 14 houses impacted.
Mm-hmm. You're in favor of this?
It is. It's a risky area.
Yeah. Maybe we could hear from some of the public.
I'm sorry?
A lot of these people are from Warren Street. So.
Yes, sir. Please identify yourself.
My name is Mark Burrell. I am the gentleman that owns 68 Warren. I've been there for 2 years now, and this is only recently, just this past summer, come to be an issue since they paved the road. Since they paved it, it's just a highway. People come through there 50, 60 miles an hour, and they don't slow down. I would be in favor of something other than the parking ban, like street signs that say, you know, there's a hill, be careful, a caution sign, even a mirror, you know, one of those panoramic mirrors that you can put at the top so people can see both ways. I've walked that road, I walk it every day with my dog, and from roughly 49 Warren Street, you can see the top of the hill. It's not as blind as it's being made out to be. On the other side from 86, you can see the top of the hill. You have to pay attention. You can't be doing, you know, a high rate of speed, otherwise you're gonna hit somebody. Where my property meets the road, sorry, and where I've parked on the side of the road, if you come up on at a high rate of speed with my neighbor parking in the road, there is no room. But to ban parking there effectively tells me that I can't have company in my house. My driveway is only big enough for one car. If I bring my car further into my property, I can't get out of my car because there's a concrete wall from my neighbor and my house. You can't open the car door to get out of my car. So I can't put my car any further into the driveway. If I have company and you ban it, they've got to walk a third to an eighth of a mile down the road to get to my house. That's not fair to me. I'm a taxpayer. I pay my taxes. I should be able to park in front of my house. You know, it's not my issue with the people that speed there. They should slow down. I moved in that area. I was told there was a high police presence. I never see any cops on that road. If you have a more police presence, people aren't going to go speeding through there. They'll slow down and do the speed limit.
What do you do from October to April with this no on street parking?
I don't have people in the wintertime at my house. I only have people in my, I have people come from around the world that stay at my house during bike week, in the beginning of the summer, and throughout the summer. Wintertime comes, it settles to nothing. I can't have the people that come from, I have people from Luxembourg, Germany that come for a week, for bike week. What am I going to tell them? Park down the street in the parking garage? It's not fair to them. They come because my house is conveniently located in Laconia to go to bike week, to go to Gunstock, to go to other places that hold events in the summertime. So that's what they come to my house for. They don't come to my house to park down the road, to walk to my house, and then have to walk back to their car. If the people making the complaint, which I have no clue who they are, but I'm sure it's some of the ones that are going through there doing 50, 60 miles an hour. If they would slow down and pay attention, it wouldn't be an issue. Or if the city would put up signs warning people that there's a blind spot on the hill, or put up one of those panoramic mirrors so people can see on both sides, the ban wouldn't have to go into effect. And that's my position.
Okay, thank you. You want to make a motion? Councilor Lippman.
I think it needs further.
Put it in the committee.
Put it in the committee to do a little further look at what our options might be. Yeah, an outright ban.
I second that.
I don't know if you're
okay. Councilor Lippman moves to refer the matter of the requested parking ban on a portion of Warren Street to the Public Safety Committee for further study and a recommendation. And that motion was seconded by Councilor Bolduc. Is that correct?
Yes.
Any further discussion or any discussion?
I looked at Councilor Hamill as his word.
No, I'm looking at this agenda here for committee reports. Now, unless I'm mistaken, isn't there a Public Works Committee? Dom is chairman of it, and I don't see it on here at all. Oh, it should still be listed, so if we need to add something. So should that be on the Public Works Committee or Public Safety?
Well, I would say Public Safety, given the reason for doing this.
I think the last ones actually were referred to Government Operations and Ordinances.
That's what I think.
Those are the ones that we did on Haven and a few other streets in the last 6 months or so. But either one, Public Safety or...
I don't think it makes a difference.
Councilor Bear's committee has a very short agenda.
There you go. I think
Councilor Doyle...
She never has anything to do, so...
All right.
Let's give this one to her.
Make a motion to refer it there.
It's already been made.
Oh, it's right.
Councilor Lippman, seconded by Councilor Bolduc. So we're discussing the motion to refer this to the Public Safety Committee for study and recommendation. Any further discussion? All those in favor, please raise a hand. 5 votes in the affirmative. And that should be added as item B under the Public Safety Committee. Thank you.
Can we schedule that tonight?
Yes, we could. I don't know if I will.
Okay.
Pretty pleased with Sugar Run-It?
Yeah.
Oh, you're going to schedule a meeting?
Yeah.
All right.
Is there a way I can find out when that meeting is going to be?
We're going to schedule it right
now. Hold on just a minute. Mm.
Probably February 13th, our first meeting in February.
I'm not going to be here.
Oh, that's too bad.
We'll have to be part of your committee, Brenda.
Well, two is a quorum, so otherwise it would be another month. It would be the 27th of February. Armin?
Well, you're not going to be here on the 27th either.
Not likely.
It's not going to be.
I'm
going to
be out for most of the month of February.
Good. Well,
he's been called to the Trump White House for advisory. month of February.
Armin, how about the 13th of February at? What do you want? An hour or a half hour?
I think it's Councilor Doyle.
Councilor
Doyle.
Doyle, and she's not here, Ava. And you're not going to be here.
No, schedule it for March.
They're waiting. You love to postpone things.
Well,
I'm going to put it down for the 13th of February at 6:30.
That's in the morning, right?
Yes. And if we have a quorum, we'll just go ahead and do it.
Okay, Councilor Bear has scheduled a meeting of the Public Safety Committee to take up item B for February 13th in this room at 6:30.
P.M. or A.M.?
P.M.
You'll be here all alone if it's A.M.
Thank you.
A.M. Okay.
Move on.
We'll have to vote on it.
Unfinished business. Item one, we don't have any unfinished business on that tonight, but I would ask the city manager to remind us and the public of the deadlines one last time here.
I believe we had all questions in writing were due to us by no later than February 3rd, which is a Friday, and we would respond to all questions in writing and post them as part of the advertising for proposals on the website, and then the final proposals were due to the city at the close, no later than the close of business on Friday, February 10th, and close of business here in City Hall is 4:30. Doors are locked.
Okay.
We did respond to two questions from one individual last week and did add those as a Q&A type of thing to the website, as we indicated we would. So
a reminder to everyone then that if you have an interest in purchasing the city-owned property at 23 Elm Street, which is the old Lakeport Fire Station, and additional parcels in close proximity, those offers are due to the city by February 10th at the very latest. And any questions should be directed to the city manager's office by the 3rd, correct?
Yes.
Okay, second item under unfinished business is update on the effort to resolve the issue with maintaining unaccepted and private streets. And we welcome Public Works Director Wes Anderson.
Lights.
There we go. This is an update from the last meeting, and we're just going to be focusing on the next step in the process, although I'm showing some of the slides from last week and saying which pieces we're working on. Again, the purpose is for tonight is explain the concept to resolve the issue, in particular focusing on emergency lanes and what we're doing, accepting as is our test case. We're going to ask tonight that the council will schedule a public hearing to designate six streets as emergency lanes, and then in the future, continuation of the plan to resolve the issue. These are the slides that we're talking about tonight. Again, we're just going to focus on those things that pertain to those aspects or those six roads, the emergency lanes, and the two roads we're using as test cases. Again, the statute says our sovereign immunity is restricted to class 4 and class 5 public highways. The roads we're talking about tonight are not public highways, and at some point in the future we've got to update NHDOT on how many miles of roads that are actually public highways. So we're focusing on that timeline at the same time.
Can you back up a second?
Okay.
I'd like further explanation of that second.
The sovereign immunity?
No, the
NHDOT status.
The class six and the private roads, basically because the city's not supposed to spend government dollars on maintaining those roads, we don't get block grant dollars for those.
Any block grant money?
Any block grant for those.
So what you're saying is if you're maintaining 1 inch of private roadway, you're not eligible for any block grant money?
Correct, because it's on those roads. So if we have 80 roads, if we have 80 roads,
no block grant money.
We're just not for those that portion of it. So if it's 7 miles, we got to take 7 miles off of 80, and we'll be eligible then for 73 miles.
I want to make sure we all understand this. So, how much money is at stake?
Typically, we're about 300,000, roughly. 7 miles is roughly 10%. So we're talking about $30,000. Roughly, right. Depending upon.
So if we have $30,000 at risk here.
Correct.
Theoretically.
Yep.
Okay. If we violate this.
Correct.
Okay.
Again, we're focusing on emergency lanes tonight. Just as a reminder, public funds for once they're designated as emergency lane can be spent to keep a road passable for emergency equipment. However, the key factor there is it cannot be used just for the benefit of the abutting landowners. And when you see the slides that we're presenting tonight for the six, you'll understand how we're applying it in this case. There are four options that are available for each road. Again, we'll be talking emergency lanes, and then we'll be talking two streets that are test cases for accepting in present condition. We've modified our plan a little bit based off what we've found to date and what our discussion with the city's attorney. We're going to focus first on the paved streets in the downtown and Lakeport area, then the paved streets in the rural area, and then go to Weirs Beach and the gravel streets. And the really exceptions will fit in as appropriate. An update here is further research determined that dedication acceptance really
can you back up one slide, please?
Pardon? Okay.
So on behalf of Councilor Doyle, I have to ask about, and she's not here tonight, about why Weirs Beach area and is a low priority.
We think that's going to be the toughest one based off of some of our research to date. We probably will be able to solve the other ones earlier than that, and that's just because of some of the issues dealing with the old Methodist campground area. We may not be able to find records per se. So we're tackling the ones we can get knocked out fast or give us the best training on how to do it to apply to other streets.
Thank you.
And again, as a reminder, we're working through this process. We're not discontinuing any sort of maintenance on any streets that we have been maintaining as we go through this process. So if something comes first, it's, as Wes said, it's kind of the easier picking and kind of shorten the list, and then we can really hone in on some of the more challenging streets.
Dedication acceptance was one of the options that we're looking at, and we're working with the attorneys because basically we've determined that between 1842 and 1945 that was not an option. So we're trying to figure out if that applies to streets that were originally built during that time frame. More to follow on that. So what we're really going to be focused on layout, which does apply for no matter when the road was built. Again, prescription is not an option for any road constructed basically after January 1, 1948. This is what we've done working with the attorney and doing the research. Basically, if we find a street that we cannot find any records on and we have to generate it from ground zero, it's basically we're treating it as a new street for the approval process. At some point, there's going to have to be a petition to have it accepted. That could petition could be submitted by me, any of the council members, or anybody who's a resident. If it hasn't been surveyed, we can't find a survey on it, we're going to have to do it. Because the way the law is written, even though the street may be there, we're going to have to send it to the planning board to have them approve to build a street in that area. And then once that all done, we'll have a public hearing with all the mortgagees, with all the abutters and the mortgage holders there. And we have to provide 30 days notice, and then and only then can we have the council vote to accept it.
Is this by state statute?
Correct.
Now, if I'm confused here, if we said you can keep your money for that street, so the highway program, can we skip this?
If we say it's not a public highway, then we don't have to go through this. But also at the in-state wise, that also means we can't spend public money on it, and at some point we're going to have to stop plowing and providing public services.
Sorry. That's not what I meant. What I meant was, is all this necessary if we accept it as a public street?
This is the process how you accept a road as a public street. There's going back. That's the only four ways of accepting it as a public street. So prescription is not going to fit or be applicable in most of our streets. Deeded ownership won't be applicable in most of our streets. So it's dedication, acceptance, and layout.
But we're not allowed to maintain unofficial, I don't know what the right word is, streets at a risk if we do, we're going to lose block grant funding for that street.
And you're also not covered by your insurance company for any accident damages on it, and they won't cover you for any legal costs associated with any accidents that do occur on that street.
Okay.
Basically, this whole process started in 2008, roughly, when Primex and the other insurance companies started notifying the municipalities that there was a major issue statewide in this problem, and the municipalities started working through the process to resolve the issue.
This is a statewide problem. We're not the only community that's suffering from this. What are the other communities doing? Are they following this approach?
Correct. Belmont designated a lot of their issue streets as emergency lanes when they fit the definition.
Yeah.
Moultonboro is just now starting to go through the process.
Moultonboro has 200 miles of streets that they are working through. 200.
Wow.
That they have no record that they're public roads?
Mm-hmm. And some they've identified are private, but they've been choosing to maintain them with the full knowledge that they're private roads.
So I guess we get back to what Councilor Libman suggested last week. Maybe what we need to do is get the law changed.
And it might, but I think that's part of, and again, I want to stress, we're not cutting off service from anybody. And if we do identify some challenges, we want to work through the ones that we can resolve ourselves. Right. And then that will help us focus what we would want to go to our legislators with and say, this specifically is what we need your help with versus, you know, hey, we got this big can of worms. We're going to work through the majority of these, I believe, as the process unfolds. Then I believe it's the appropriate time and perfectly willing to speak with our delegation, members of our delegation, to help start this. And I think we would have support from other communities. But I think we have to kind of hone in as to what it is we're really going to ask them to be the fix.
Councilor Libman.
I guess I have another concern that arises from the fact that mortgagees have to be contacted. Are we somehow affecting the property values of people in the short term with respect to having to bring that forward in that fashion?
But that's, I want to stress, the only time we notify the mortgage holders is when we're going through the acceptance process. So we've already identified the issue, we've identified the resolution for it, and we're in that final stages.
So I guess what I'm getting at is the manager laid out a, you know, we're trying to correct what we can correct, right? But in correcting something, are we then causing a financial issue for the people in the process of correction? In other words, you've laid out a process there, if you go back a couple slides, you know, that doesn't look like a week or two kind of process. If someone, for example, has their house on the market, you know, and that takes 6 or 9 months to accomplish, and they can't sell their house at the same value that it otherwise would have been sold at, I think we're having an impact on people.
My question would be, what's the cost of that?
That piece is, we're still in the process of estimating. We got the mailing costs, we got the public hearing costs. Your biggest costs are probably going to be associated with the survey of the street, which depends upon its length. And hopefully, because the layout process requires us to fairly pay the owners of the land for putting the right-of-way on top of it, the cost of doing that, but there's an exception to it, and it can be $1. They can waive their rights, and there's just that $1 charge. So working through this process, we're going to try to, you know, if we have to do it that way, we're going to try to get it so the homeowners all waive that portion, and it's just the dollar. So the biggest cost will be all the surveying costs associated with getting the information we need to actually lay out
the survey street. 7 miles of roads.
Correct.
Well, that's probably something we can deal with by statute if we need to. But so this procedure or the emergency lane procedure is essentially our two options, right?
We may find some streets as we're going through the records. When we get to the later slides, we're going to talk Park Street. So far, we're back to 1864 on Park Street, and we think that's a 1700s era, so that means dedication and acceptance is an option in that matter. So it's
because it goes prior to 1948?
It goes prior to 1842.
Yeah, okay.
You were here, don't you remember that?
No, I'm a little vague about the details.
That was even before Councilor Bullock joined the council.
Really? God, that's amazing. I had a discussion with West, and the state, West can correct me or help me with this, was in 2008 or something, came up with a plan on for the emergency.
The emergency lane dates
emergency
back
lane
to,
designation.
Actually dates back to 1990, and that was part of the effort to give the municipalities a solution to being able to do something for private roads.
Right.
And that's sort of the, I'll call it, the compromise that came between the two different groups to solve it.
And since then, they tried
2012, and it didn't go any place that year.
And they just left it alone. They didn't want to touch it.
So the next step in the process is the emergency lane designations for six roads. Again, we're going to ask for a public hearing to be scheduled for that, and then we're going to talk the two test cases we're doing for as-is streets, Tremont and Park. Whoops, went wrong way.
Tremont and Park.
Yes.
Tremont's by the fire station.
Yeah. Correct, and Park's the middle lane between Railroad Ave and Ford down on Lakeport.
Park Street's the street the Baptist Church is on in Lakeport.
Okay, so first emergency lane is the Bell Street extension. That's at the end of Chapin Terrace. Intersects with Franklin Street. It's a paper street that...
It's not even paved, is it?
No, it's loosely termed, in my terminology, it's a trail. Nothing's been built, but enough traffic's gone over it. You can find a path to get through. Basically, we use it for being able to turn around our plow equipment. They go up Chapin Terrace. They'll make the right onto that paper street and then get back onto Franklin to continue their plow routes. It's just too tight to do a U-turn at the end of Chapin. The next one is that crossover street between Durkee and Addison. That's actually built on private property. We don't have any right to be on it other than a handshake right now. So
didn't they offer to give it to the city?
We're going to have to work through that process. So
that's off of Court Street, for those of you who aren't familiar with where that street is.
So that's one of the emergency lanes. Next one is Channel Lane. Of course, that's the comes off of Endicott Street, goes down against by the bridge, goes to the dead end road. We have a pump station at the far west corner that supports those buildings and residences there. That gives us the ability, being over and above supporting the abutters, to maintain that pump station. So that's our ability for this one. Hillcrest Drive, again, we have a pump station at the far northeast corner. On this particular case, that first turn as you're coming off White Oaks Road, that portion has been accepted. The southern loop was close to being accepted, and the eastern portion of the loop never even got to the point of even being considered being accepted.
What happened?
We don't know. All we know is that the planning board recommended the southern portion be accepted. There was some issues come up, and then the person who was trying to complete it after the developer failed stopped, and that piece never continued, and the other phase that never even got to that point never continued.
So the northernmost street there was accepted?
This portion right there, that section right there was accepted, and that stayed there for a long time. Then another developer came in to build this portion there coming around. Okay. And this portion from here to here, we have found paperwork that says it was ready for acceptance. The planning board recommended it to be accepted, but it never came up to city council for acceptance. This portion right here, we find no records other than it was built.
And that's new, relatively new.
Correct.
It's in rough shape, though.
Can't we bring it to the city council now?
We want to get this piece done first, get it accepted as emergency lane, and then bring it through the process. Because this piece just say we've got to work out and do some more research. But the justification behind it is we have to maintain this section of road, and we have to maintain our pump station at the end.
So are we designating as an emergency lane?
To get us to the point...
Both portion of the roads that have been voted by the planning board to accept, that never made it to the city council?
Correct. We're doing that now to get us to the point where we're covered underneath insurance till we can correct all the paperwork and get it taken care of.
When did the planning board vote on this? Do you know?
I think it was either 2008 or 2010. I've been looking at so many files, I don't want to...
It's okay. I'm not holding you to it.
Yeah. Next one is Lane Road. That's the crossover that goes between Meredith Center and Parade Road. It's a combination for plowing, of course, for emergency vehicles to be able to go from one of our major avenues to the other major avenue. And the last one is Pickerel Pond Road, which is further up in that corridor, goes between Meredith Center and Parade. And gives us the ability for emergency equipment to rapidly shift from one road to another road. So those are the six that we're asking to be declared as emergency lanes and for you to schedule a public hearing. The next are the two as-is streets that we've been using as our test case. The first one is Park Street. That's the middle of the three roads in Lakeport area. As I was saying, we're back to 1864. We know the road was there at that point. Some of the records that leads us to believe it probably was built sometime in the 1700s. My surveyor's getting ready to go down to the state archives to see if we can find anything on it, and then we'll go from there. And maybe at some point we can't find the information and we'll have to go through the layout process or the dedication acceptance process for this street.
We're spending a fair amount of staff time on this.
This piece was, I want to say we're probably about 5 to 10 hours into it. Tremont Street, the next one, we've been about 30 hours into it, but we've had success on that one.
This is crazy.
Okay, so any questions on Park Street? Tremont's the last one. That's the one, of course, beside the main fire station off of North Main Street. After about 30 hours, we had enough records. We found enough that led us to believe that in 1894, it was laid out. The council blessed it, approved it, and that we paid the resident who owned the property at that point. So we have both the layout and the return, as they call it, for paying for the damages of taking it in documentation, even though we don't have a signed layout. That's with the attorney now.
And these test cases go for roads, streets that were there prior to 1948.
Correct.
That the magic number?
That's the magic number.
And you've only been able to identify two roads that go before 1948?
Well, there's plenty of roads before that, but we took two cases that were sort of represented.
Oh, okay. All right.
The downtown core and the Lakeport.
All right.
Because that would give us the best chance of figuring out how to tackle it from there on.
Okay. I understand.
So that packet is with the city attorney now, and they're reviewing it to determine if all the documentation we found is sufficient to determine it has been accepted. So that this one we may not have to continue any further. We should know that by the next council meeting. Subject to your questions, that concludes my presentation.
Get the lights on.
I got a question.
Councilor Hamill has a question.
Wes, in order to accept a street or a street be accepted, what exactly entails all of the paperwork that needs to be, and not just the surveying, but what else has to be accounted for?
Okay, I'll break it down into dedication and acceptance. Dedication is basically a developer or someone has built it and says, I'm dedicating to the city, and they have given us all the paperwork, basically to say this is where the street is with all the survey information. At that point, if it's been built to standard under normal process, planning board recommends it to city council to approve, the legislative body, the city council approves it, and the street's been accepted. If it's the layout process, it is basically what you could say, not truly eminent domain, but you're building a road on someone else's property. You're getting permission by paying them for that right-of-way on top of it. That's what they call the return for it. You're putting the survey in place saying, this is where the road is. You're getting that portion blessed. You're paying them. Then it goes to city council for approval.
Now, on your surveys, is just the surface of the road, or do you have to also put in whatever
just the surface
drainage,
of the road,
any of that stuff?
It's basically it's the ends of the right of way, the left and right, or east, north, and south, whatever it happens to be, in whatever direction. It's the limits of the right of way.
Plus, these roads have to be within city specifications to be accepted as far as...
Well, that's part of the discussion that we'll have further on. If it's a new street getting ready to be accepted by the city, yes, it has to meet city standards and specifications.
Like,
if it's one of these old ones, then it's going to be up to the council to make that
any
decision.
Lane would have to be up to standards, current standards. But we can accept...
Correct.
Park Street or whatever.
Correct.
Okay. Councilor Lippman.
You know, I think you've laid out something that according to the rules and regulations that exist, but again, after listening to this, I take the position that while I think it's well thought out and well constructed, I think it's an expensive and potentially unnecessary process for us to go through. I don't think the risks are, again, you know, Armin, I don't know how many the years of council you've been on council where the city's been sued on any of these areas. You know, you've been on the council for more than 30 years. I've been on the council almost a little more than a decade, 12 years. I'd like to see us pursue a legislative solution to this before we, you know, we may have to do what you just outline as a process, but it just seems like a monstrous amount of work that has to be done, a monstrous amount of expense, inconvenience of our residents. You know, maybe there is no way to avoid it, but I think we should give it the college try before we go down this path.
To your knowledge, to date, of the 7 miles, are there any instances that you're aware of where it is common knowledge that it is indeed a private street and the owner or owners of that private street want it to stay that way?
Yes.
How big? Or how?
I can give you one example. I've got a couple more I'm not 100% sure of, and that's Pendleton Beach. Right now, we're plowing and salting that. It's private, according to Mr. Hutchins, whom I met with. He basically says that it's in their deed that street can never become public. So.
But they want the city to keep maintaining it.
Correct.
So that would be a real issue.
Yes.
The others probably are situations where if it is private, the people who, quote, own it don't even know they own it.
Correct.
Or would happily give it up for a dollar or whatever in return for maintenance.
Yes.
So do you, Counselor, do you object to taking this step tonight of declaring, setting a public hearing to declare these as emergency lanes, these 6 streets? That's what we're being asked to do tonight.
As much as it pains me to object, I do object. And I just think that we need, once we launch down this road, we're kind of, you know, sucked into the vortex of working it through. And I want no criticism of public work, no criticism of the administration of this. I just think, put myself in the position of living on these streets and saying, you know, in most instances, maybe other than the instance of Pendleton, you know, this is a surprise that my mortgage company is going to get a notification. Somehow this compromises, you know, my situation. I just, you know, I feel like I'm representing, and I don't know how many people in my ward are that, but just I always viewed my job as not just representing my ward, but representing the city. I just feel for the citizens to put them through all this is just, it's an ordeal. And if we can avoid it somehow, that would be my preference. And I'm conceding up front that there may not be a way to do that.
Councilor Hamel.
I totally agree with Henry on this, but what I'm going to do is take the other side also. And looking at the people who live in Laconia altogether. We've got 7 miles of road that's questionable amongst 80 miles of streets that we do. And what I don't want to see, I mean, granted, I don't know if anything has happened. I don't think we've ever got sued over it. I have no idea. But now that it's out in the open, that these are our private roads and we're maintaining them, and our insurance company said they would not cover us. Maybe something could happen that instead of costing us tens of thousands, it might be hundreds of thousands that everybody else is going to have to pick up. And we know that those roads are not accepted. That's, I mean, I know it, and you know it now. So we're knowingly saying we're not going to do something about something that might hurt us in the future. I agree with you. To me, it's a legislative thing, and this might be here because of, well, it started with Primex, right? So
correct.
The insurance company is the one that started this, if that's going to say anything. I doubt if we can go to them and say, you know, this is going to take us a few years to get through this, maybe more. I have no idea. You want to cover us till then? What's their answer going to be? I mean, that could be a legitimate question to them, but I don't know. But I agree with you as far as the burden on the people who live on these streets and roads. But as a council representing the city and all the taxpayers in it, you know, we got an obligation to reduce mitigation as much as possible, litigation.
Councilor Bolduc?
Yeah, I have the same problem. How many years have we been doing this, and I've never had a problem? Now all of a sudden we got a big problem. There are streets that I've been on that are better shaped than the ones that we're plowing today that are that are supposed to be normal streets. And I'm having a hard time to vote on anything here because I don't know why is it we've gone so many years without this problem before? How come all of a sudden it's a problem?
It's because the insurance company brought it up.
That's the easy answer.
Tremont Street brought it up, right? That was my understanding.
Tremont was one of the streets about the same time we had the water main issue and trying to fix that. We also had a resident one that Dirt Roads asked when they were going to be paved, and that sort of opened up the question, and I found the list.
We've identified a list even before my time getting here, and Councilor Bear, you know, we discontinued some service on some roads in your ward, so it's not something that just came up in the last 6 months or so. I mean, this has been going on for several years, and
you know, there was an issue off Frank Bean Road there at one point in time, wasn't there? I can't remember the name of the street.
Barbara Avenue and Joanne Terrace.
Right, and we discontinued the maintenance of those with notice, and we discontinued a couple of years ago.
So let me understand this liability issue. So you're saying that as of today, I shouldn't put words in your mouth, trying to understand it. If something terrible happens on Pickerel Pond Road, we have no liability insurance on Purple Pond Road. Is that what you're saying?
Correct.
Do we have sovereign immunity?
No.
Okay. So as of today, if something terrible happens on Purple Pond Road, we're on our own.
Correct.
But what, when you say that, what caused the accident? Was it speed, or was it just because the road wasn't in good shape? I mean,
Well, I'm saying that if there was a bad accident, for example, there and someone was either seriously injured or killed, and they argued that the reason for it is because we didn't properly maintain the road. Okay, we didn't salt it, we didn't sand it, we didn't plow it in time, whatever the thing is. If somebody, if the damaged party sued the city, what he's saying is, if I understand it, is one, we don't have sovereign immunity from such a suit, and two, we wouldn't have any insurance coverage. So we would be defending ourselves, and if the judgment went against us, we'd be paying it ourselves.
I don't know.
Is that correct?
Correct.
We've gone all these years without anything, and now all of a sudden we...
I don't know what the likelihood of that is,
Have we confirmed that with the legal folks in terms of liability and immunity and all of those issues?
Basically, what it, and talking with the attorneys on the matter, what it really comes down to is the fact that the way the laws are written, if it's not an accepted street, it's treated as private. And by the way, the state law is written, we are not supposed to be on a private road. We are violating the law. Therefore, we're not covered by the insurance because we're violating statute. And then anything that we take at that point is at our own risk.
From a practical point of view, we've never run into this liability issue with the private public road situation in the past.
That's what I'm saying.
You're not sure?
I found one case in the files as I was going through them where we did have an insurance claim against us on one of these roads, and it was handled underneath insurance, but that was fairly old before we recognized it. And really, this was a small dollar, but did have one in there from what I've been able to find.
Are you finished?
No.
Oh, sorry.
Go ahead. If I can just, I don't see what the harm is at this point in time of taking the six roads and declaring them, holding a public hearing on them as emergency roads, because that addresses the problem once and for all. And the problem has already been laid out, so it's not like we're going to alert people to what the issue is. And we've got to be candid with them anyway. But I do see a lot of reasons to follow Henry's lead with respect to the rest of the streets. Now, Tremont Street may be a slam dunk in terms of acceptance in the pre-1948 mode, but I'm reluctant to keep up the cost and keep going at it when it seems to me that a legislative solution to this issue, principally because it's a statewide problem, and every legislature is going to listen to their own situation, that a fix to the statute would resolve it, that would eliminate a lot of the costs, the surveys, the process.
Yeah, that matrix he showed up there with the, that's what we're talking about in terms of legislative relief is,
right.
Can we short-circuit?
Can we short-circuit the process?
All that process and expense.
Well, you're going to have somebody introduce a bill?
Yeah.
Yeah. Could somebody sponsor?
Has the Municipal Association gotten involved in this issue?
Mm-mm. Do you have any connections?
So your suggestion, I'm sorry, you were next.
I mean, look, I'm not sure. what you're saying is sensible to me, but I'm not sure if we're exposing the property owners on those six streets to something with their mortgage companies, as an example, that would be...
I mean, that won't do that.
Negative...
That won't do that.
Would have some negative impact on them?
You're just saying that you can plow...
One at a time. Go ahead.
Well, he can answer that better than...
There is no requirement to notify mortgage holders on the emergency lane. The only people we have to notify are the abutters.
Okay.
So Councilor Bowens is suggesting a two-pronged approach. One would be to schedule a public hearing for these six streets as emergency ways, and two, to focus on that matrix, for lack of a better word, in terms of trying to meet with our legislative delegation sooner rather than later to see if we can find a resolution, a legislative resolution, to short-circuiting that process.
Wouldn't it probably take as long to go through the legislative process as it would be to go through the matrix?
But nowhere near the expense.
You might be talking...
It's going to cost us a lot of money.
$10,000 a street to have a survey.
We have to do that on every...
And the other thing is, the ones that are being plowed now, even though they're unimproved, what happens to those streets we are not doing? Are they not going to, like Joanna Terrace or, you know, Barbara Boulevard, are they going to say, well, I mean, are they not entitled to be plowed or sanded?
We took them off a few years ago.
Well, yes, but...
Some of them.
Yes, but there are others out there that we're not plowing or taking care of. And if you do it for those who we're doing it for now, what's going to happen to the... Are we supposed to only consider those, you know?
It's fleeting, yet.
But still, if it's private, it's private, so...
Well, to me, if you're a private road and you don't want to become public, you should maintain your own property.
I'm sorry, say that last sentence again.
No, I said, if you have a private road and you do not want to become a public street, you should maintain, the people, the owners, should maintain their own property.
That's why I asked the question, and apparently there's very little of this that fits that description. But yes, if it's a private road and you know it's a private road and you want it to stay a private road, then that's another matter.
That's right.
But I think it's a different scenario where you've been taken care of for 20, 30, 40 years.
Yeah.
And
I mean, I doubt the people on Hillcrest in the affected areas know that's a private road, or at least didn't know it until recently.
And there's another huge development going up in that area.
Yeah.
So new developments end up being accepted or not. So
all right. Well, let's do things one at a time here. Is there any counselor who would like to make a motion to act on the stack recommendation to schedule a public hearing for February 3rd to designate Bell Street, Crossover Street, Channel Lane, Hillcrest Street, Lane Road, and Pickerel Pond Road as emergency lanes?
I'll make that motion.
Just on a technical basis, it's February 13th.
What did I say?
3rd.
February
13th.
Right. So the motion would be to schedule a public hearing on February 13th on the concept of declaring as emergency lanes Bell Street, Crossover Street, Channel Lane, Hillcrest Street, Lane Road, and Pickerel Pond Road. And the motion was made by Councilor Bowens.
Second.
Correct?
Yes.
And seconded over here, Councilor Baer.
Point of clarification is Hillcrest as the entire loop or just a portion thereof?
Just
all the portions that are not public.
No, correct.
So at the end
about
of that...
About two-thirds of it.
At the end of it, it would be the whole thing.
Correct.
The whole loop?
Yeah.
Okay.
Effectively the whole loop.
Okay. Any further discussion? Okay, all those in favor of scheduling that public hearing, please raise a hand. We have 5 votes in the affirmative, and that action is taken. Now, we don't need to do anything tonight on Park and Tremont, correct?
No, sir. That was just for your information, mm-hmm. from what we're finding to date.
Okay, do we want to instruct at this point in time the city manager to pursue the legislative angle or to take the first step toward doing that? And if so, how?
Yeah, if so, how? And I also, I really applaud the hard work you put on this, but I want to curtail our efforts until we find out if there's a legislative answer to this. I mean, we've got the work done on Park Street and Tremont Street. You might as well finish off with Park, but I just don't want to be dedicating city resources to this issue if there is a legislative answer. Not that you might not have to do it anyway, but I just want to sort of put a hold on everything.
Councilor Littman.
Just like a clarification for the people who be affected by the public hearing, that in terms of the cost to the city and cost to the homeowners, if any?
Emergency lane is totally, well, can't say free. From our standpoint is we're not required to charge the residents for emergency lane designation.
We'll have to do mailings to the physical abutters on the street. We'll have to advertise in the newspaper. But beyond there, there's no additional expense to the city and there's no expense to those residents.
So I guess the next step would be, as far as the legislation is concerned, would be to have a meeting or meetings with our legislative delegation, perhaps our state senator. So the question would be, do you want to ask them to come to a council meeting, or would the best first step would be to have the manager and perhaps one or two others meet with them privately?
I think that the latter would be.
Any consensus on that?
Yeah.
Could I offer up a, could we allow
you may
legal and or NHMA to see if we can identify what specifically is we'd be seeking to correct legislatively? I think if we sit down and say this is the problem, and not critiquing anybody, they're not going to be any more up to speed on it
right
than some of us are. So I think if you allow us to identify, you know, not only what the end result is but the approach to get there, may make it for a more beneficial meeting all the way around.
Councilor Hamel.
Would the the municipal organization, would it be better to go through them, where, I mean, this is a statewide matter, and they could, I mean, they represent the towns and cities as it is.
As a lobby.
To have them.
So the Municipal Association does a number of things. They do have a legal hotline, but that's basically for answering specific questions. It may not be for
legislation.
Hey, help us craft the legal solution to all of this. And another component of what the association does is then lobby and take a position if the board and the membership has supported that position. So I think if we identify what we hope the fix could be, working with our legal counsel and maybe another, you know, community of Moultonboro, I believe, is going through a different legal office, maybe a couple of legal minds together helping to craft what a fix might be, and then we're able to look for sponsors, you know, hopefully within our own legislative delegation, and if not there, certainly elsewhere. We can certainly find other communities that are facing similar challenges, go that approach, and that's where the Municipal Association would then have the ability as a board of directors to take a position and then follow that bill and take appropriate action.
And I don't think that we should just focus on the state Senate. I think we need to focus on the House too.
Absolutely.
Well, I said the delegation.
Yeah.
Okay.
Our delegation. Councilor Littman.
Another follow-up question: as an emergency lane designation, if the road is then classified as what with respect to the future maintenance and cost of that road?
The limitation of emergency lane is we have to keep the road passable. And when you look at the state statute on it, it talks about things like keeping trees off of it, replacing culverts that you can't cross, that sort of thing. It also infers that you shouldn't be repaving or doing high-end maintenance. It's really just to keep it passable for emergency equipment to get to the various properties on the street.
But we're viewing this as a short-term fix.
Correct. This is to get us to the point where we're out of the issue with not being covered by insurance.
Yes, go ahead.
And if we were to make that designation and then were successful in somehow changing legislative position on that, we could reverse that designation and do something else?
We can. Actually, the way the ordinance is written, we can just stop and the emergency lane goes away, and the fact that we've accepted it takes priority.
Or just keep doing what we have been.
Correct.
Okay.
Go ahead.
The legislative part of that, would that also include the insurance company accepting what the state says, or do they still have?
Once we've accepted it, it becomes a public highway.
Yeah. No. I mean, what I mean is,
it's either accepted or it's not.
Yeah,
once
so
it's
I mean,
accepted,
if the
it's
state
covered.
Produces legislation and it passes, that whatever we're trying to do now goes away. So then the insurance company has to insure those roads as far as liability.
They're not going to play a role in,
no.
in what constitutes or what process is used to
correct.
Declare an accepted street.
They all would they only just want it, has it been accepted by the city council?
Okay.
All right, so what I would suggest with the consent of the council is that the city manager and I, over the next week or so, meet and come up with a game plan on this, a specific game plan, and then we can come back and brief the council. Taking into consideration both the legislative delegation and the National Municipal Association, come up with a game specific game plan.
Yeah, that's fine. But
go ahead.
So if the state does this, but we're still in a position of, if it's a private road, we don't fix it. If it's a road that's not accepted already, which a lot of these is, that's the problem, they're not accepted. So does that still kind of leave us in the same position once, even if this gets cleared up in the state?
If if it was a, and I got to put this carefully, it was a road that was intended to become a public highway, and we've accepted it, then that takes it into the public highway field or arena, and it's no longer an unaccepted street. You could still have private roads out there that the homeowners may not want to make public that we're still going to have to deal with. We haven't got into that piece yet. All we've been focusing on right now to learn the process is on those that we know that have been, should have been accepted, were intended to be public. The process just wasn't completed.
I think that, you know, Dave's point about not continuing it with anything, I don't know. I think, in my opinion, we should let Wes continue somewhat on this. I mean, if this doesn't go through, then we're going to be that much further ahead. If he stops doing anything, there's still liabilities that we got to deal with in streets that we don't know what circumstances we're going to find with them. I think we ought to let him continue.
If I may, the other advantage of continuing it gives us more information that we can provide to the delegation in regards to what we're finding to help work the process through to get any changes that we want done at the legislative level.
Where we got streets that date back to
right.
the 1700s or 1800s that may not have the information.
Councilor Lippman.
I just don't like the idea of an open checkbook on what we spend here on this project. I think I'd ask the manager to give us a come back at the next meeting, our next meeting, to give us some sense of what we expect to spend over some period of time here. Just
so how about a delay to February 13th? In which case we can get a report from Wes and the manager about what kind of expenditure we'd be looking at to continue the process.
That would give us a chance to start a conversation with legal as well. In the meantime, we'd be moving the 6 emergency lanes to public hearing. And can I just get consensus if we're there on Tremont and or Park or with minimal additional effort, and we think those are going to be two kind of slam dunks, can we continue, because we've gone very far, both of them.
That was the consensus, that Park and Tremont.
I just want to make sure that we can continue those two. We'll
but
do
not
the 6
on any other streets
lanes,
until February
13th. We'll regroup, we'll bring some additional information, and we'll update the council.
Well,
I don't have a problem with that, but as I look at it, the streets that we can accept as is, right now that you've laid out, Park Street, Tremont Street, Elm Street, Pleasant Street, Gold Street, North Main Street, those streets, I don't know how far you are along in that process, and I don't know technically what you think you have to
North
do.
North Main Street.
North Main Street, can you believe it?
I think that's the short section that's down there by Veterans Square, which in that particular case, we just got to match reconstruction to the earlier plans.
I mean, so. Pleasant Street, please.
Okay. All right, so we all on the same page here?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
At least where we're getting by February 13th. You're going to get two reports back on February 13th. You're going to get a report from the city manager and myself about the legislative action initiative, and you're going to get a report from the city manager and the public works director as to what the cost is going to be to continue to pursue administrative action on this other than Park and Tremont.
And I'm sure all of you will be able to deal with that on February 13th without me.
Now, I'd like to see the cost up to now.
Up to now?
Yeah.
And a good estimate, I don't.
So an estimate of how much it's cost us to research Tremont is an example of what you're talking about, correct?
Well, whatever they've done on this up to now.
I mean, Tremont's the one that's had the most work done
on. Yes.
Yeah.
I guess I'd be interested more in what, you know, your time isn't per se, your time is we're paying you whether you do this project or a different project. I think it's more what do we spend on outside legal counsel and other
outside resources. That's going to be plenty.
Okay, anything else on this subject?
No.
Thank you. Appreciate it. Okay, well, that's the end of unfinished business. We're moving on to nominations, appointments, and elections. We have three tonight. First up, we have Margaret Peggy Selig, seeking appointment to a regular position on the trustees of the trust funds for a three-year term expiring at the end of March 2019. Does someone wish to nominate Ms. Selig for that position?
I'll nominate her.
Second. Councilor Hamill, seconded by Councilor Bolick. Any discussion? All those in favor of that nomination, please raise a hand. We have five votes in the affirmative. The nomination is confirmed. Congratulations. And thank you for applying. Next up is Elizabeth Mary, seeking appointment to a regular position on the planning board. I don't have...
How many positions are open on that?
Two.
Two.
Okay.
So this...
She's a great candidate.
Yes.
Should be in the both for Charlie St. Clair and Elizabeth Mary. We've got the second paragraph under discussion that tells you the two terms that are available for the regular appointments.
So can we just arbitrarily say which is which?
You can say that you're going to appoint one person A to the term ending June 2017, and the other one would be available for June 2018.
All right. Well, unless somebody objects, we'll just take them in the order that they came here. Okay. So we would be appointing Elizabeth Mary to a position on the planning board to fill the unexpired term of Jerry Mayu.
The unexpired term.
I'm sorry?
June 2018 for Liz Mary.
Why?
Because she's really qualified.
Yeah, so is Charlie. He sits on the board already.
I didn't mean to start a fight here.
I don't care. Why? Because that was my preference. You're starting the fight. But I'm not going to fight about the year.
Okay. All right. So I was just taking them in order.
You were just reading from the piece of paper.
I was. I had no political implications whatever in this. I'm just taking them. And if somebody wants to amend the motion, that's up to you. Sure. But I'm suggesting.
Okay. I move to appoint Elizabeth Mary to the unexpired term of Warren Hutchins, expiring at the end of June 2018.
Is there a second to that motion? Seconded by Councilor Bolick. Any discussion? All those in favor of making that appointment, please raise a hand.
Doesn't much
all
matter.
Those, any against? I was five votes in the affirmative.
Yeah.
Is that correct? All right. All right. So that appointment is made for June of 2018. Next up is Charlie St. Clair, and the motion would be to appoint him to a regular position on the planning board to fill the unexpired term of Jerry Mayu, expiring at the end of June 2017. Moved by Councilor Bolduc, seconded by Councilor Bounds. Any discussion? All those in favor, please raise a hand. Any opposed?
I'm sorry.
Did you vote yes?
Voting for, yes.
Okay. We have 5 votes in the affirmative.
I'd like to point out to Councilor Bear, we'll get to reappoint him again, so.
Well, I know.
It'll be to his advantage.
He has to keep coming back.
Charlie has been on the board as an alternate for a while now.
Yes.
I thought I'd give him the option of getting off if he wanted to.
He wouldn't apply if he didn't want it.
Council comments.
I think we made him.
I think we made him, yeah. Yeah, we're on a roll here. Let's call it good. All right, we have need tonight for a non-public session, and a motion would be, and there will be no public business conducted after that session. And so we need a motion to go into non-public session according to RSA 91A:3.2D, consideration of the acquisition, sale, or lease of real or personal property, which if discussed in public would likely benefit a party or parties whose interests are adverse to those of the community. Can I have that motion, please? Moved by Councilor Bolduc, seconded by Councilor Bounds.
Did you
share? And I'd ask the clerk to please call the roll. We need a roll call vote on that.
Councilor Bounds?
Councilor Bounds.
Councilor Bounds.
Yes.
Councilor Lippman.
Yes.
Councilor Baer.
Thank you.
Yes.
Councilor Pennell.
Yes.
Councilor Bolduc.
Yes.
9:30.